Welcome to this edition of Citrus Conversations, and today I'm joined by Dr. Nian Wang. He's a professor of microbiology and soil science here at the Citrus Research and Education Center, and also our Graves Eminent Scholar Chair in Agricultural Biotechnology. Welcome, Dr. Wang.
Thank you, Dr. Roger. Thank you for the nice introduction.
Yeah, and so today we're going to be talking a little bit about CRISPR and gene editing of plants. And this is something that's gotten a lot of attention in the industry lately. We've seen our yields decline statewide quite a bit. Folks are really having a hard time hanging on and surviving right now. Currently, there's a lot of therapies that are being used in the citrus industry, and the goal is to try to keep trees productive as long as possible, but we know it's not going to last forever. Things like trunk injections are really just buying us a little bit of time until we have solutions developed to HLB. And so that's where CRISPR comes in. I think a lot of people have a lot of hope that CRISPR, this gene editing technology, is going to be the ultimate solution for us to help solve HLB. And so today we're going to talk a little bit about what is gene editing and what is CRISPR. And so we've got Dr. Wang, who's the world's leading expert on this for citrus, using gene editing technology to develop new varieties for disease resistance. And so CRISPR, now this stands for clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. That's a mouthful. And I don't want you to necessarily explain to us what all that means, but can you simplify that for us? What is CRISPR or gene editing? What are you doing with this process?
Okay, CRISPR, you know, is really a very simple adaptive immune response for the microbes. But scientists have adapted this phenomena for the genome editing. Basically, for the human gene therapy, for the plant, we do gene editing to improve the genetic resistance against disease. So has been is the first successful use for the genome editing in plant in 2013. It has a lot of progress has been made for citrus. It now has been in the research step, as we can do the transgene free gene editing. I think that's a really big step.
Okay, yeah. So backing up, I think you mentioned, so 2013 was the first time that CRISPR was ever used for editing a plant. This was not citrus, but it was done some other crop. That's 10 years ago. So this is actually a really new technology, something that when HLB first showed up in Florida, this wasn't probably even thought about at that point in time, or at least not by us, I guess.
We started in about a similar time. Okay. We got our the first paper we published in Arabidopsis rice in 2013. Actually, we submitted our paper in later 2013 as well. Okay. But was published in 2014. So basically, we started work at a similar time.
Okay.
Yeah, but eventually, it took us a long time to really reach the transgene free. That's because for other crop, they are not transgene free at the beginning either.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's a big difference, and I think the one thing we'll focus on right now is the use of the term transgene free.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is different from when we think about genetic modification in the past. We were talking about the term GMO, genetically modified organism. That was kind of a bad word in the public, because we're talking about transgenics. And so what's the difference between gene editing and talk about transgenics?
Transgenics and the transgene-free, transgenics can be in many ways, right? Normally you do the overexpression. It's really done by the, more time is done by the agrobacteria mediated. Normally is the sequence get inserted into the plant is have tDNA and also have the selection marker like kanamycin. So this is some concerns. But for the we do the genome editing, right? This can be transgenic or transgene free. So at the beginning, many crops, most genome editing is done by the transgenic approach.
Okay.
So basically, you still have the tDNA, you still have a selection marker. for the citrus, right now we did the transgene free. Basically, we can do a different approach. We basically remove without any foreign DNA, basically. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to go through the regulatory process.
So basically the difference is, like, with transgenics, you're adding something to the plant, but with this gene editing, you're basically working with what's already in the plant, not necessarily having to add stuff, but I think, as you mentioned, there are still different approaches using CRISPR that are considered transgenic, because I think there's a lot of people working on gene editing or CRISPR, but they're, most of the people who are working with citrus using CRISPR, it's still considered transgenic because they're still adding stuff to the citrus. And that's where your research is different and comes in, is that, you know, when you say transgene free, you're not adding stuff that would cause regulatory concerns for the plant.
That's right. So far, you know, many people have published on, several labs have published on the citrus gene editing in the CRISPR specifically. But so far, only our lab in UF, IFAS, has done the transgene free, use two different approach. So in our approach, we really have no foreign DNA or any tDNA or selection marker in the final product. So it's really simplify the whole deregulation process.
And the reason that we're using CRISPR, I mean, the technology itself, it's new because it allows you to go out and seek a certain DNA sequence. Maybe you couldn't do that in the past. Is that correct? Or and cut it out? Or how does that work?
In the past, actually, you can. There's many different ways. You can actually do it. Before the CRISPR, you have several other older technology can do it, but not as easy. Like a TALEN, you know, we have been working on. Citrus cancer, the citrus have the tail effector. That one was developed into TALEN, is another gene editing technology.
Okay.
That has been also used for the gene editing in many different crops, including like a citrus. Even though there's no publication, we work on that. That's why we led us to the CRISPR gene editing. But that one just much more difficult.
Okay, so CRISPR is just an easier way to do the gene editing of a specific gene of interest.
Yeah, this is the easiest way so far, and the cheapest way to do it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, can you just walk us through the steps? I think everybody would be interested to know, you know, what are the different steps in this gene editing process? Because I think people tend to think, oh, it's something can be done really quick and easy, and you have a plant, you go and you edit it, and you have a plant here tomorrow, but that's not the case. And so can you walk us through that step and the timeline to get this done?
Yeah, I think we developed two or three different technologies for the transgene free. Let me describe our first one.
Okay.
This one we started 7 years ago. You know, really, even though we started work on CRISPR probably 2013 for citrus genome editing use CRISPR technology, but transgene free there's several technology challenge we need to fix. First is a bilayer homozygous mutation. The second of all is should be transgene free. So first thing we have done, try to overcome the bilayer homozygous editing. The reason is citrus are the hybrid. They have two set of alleles for each gene basically. Sometimes you need to knock out both alleles. Okay. So at the beginning, we did a transgenic approach to make sure we can get bilayer on a homozygous mutation. Then we finally get that done in 2020, we become very thorough on that. So at the same time, right, we have been working on transgene free gene editing, actually from 2013 as well. And we begin to make a lot more effort in seeing probably 2015. But it will take a long time before we really make a big throw in 2021. Okay, so we finally generated the first set of the transgene free plant. How we did that? For this first approach, we use the embryogenic protoplast. It's really a collaboration project with Dr. Judith Grosser and several labs within UF, within CREC, IFAS. So what we do is, Jude Lab, they have the, you know, developed the embryogenic tissue culture for mm-hmm. different varieties of citrus. So we just generated an embryogenic protoplasm. We do the, use the, use the Cas12a and GuardRNA and the protein and GuardRNA. This is kind of complex. Then you do the transformation of the protoplast. Okay. Then after that, you do the this regeneration. It take a long time. It take like 10 months from the after edited like a single cell, then grow into the, you know, this type of a plant. Mm-hmm. Then you do the macro grafting into the.
So backing up, like, so the editing of the protoplast, that's at the cell level.
Yes.
So you're editing that, and then you're going to take that single cell and grow it into a plant, like you said, about that tall, which takes about a year.
Yes.
Essentially, yes. What I would call in a petri dish.
<It's> that's basic. Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. After that, you do the then you do the micro graft onto the rootstock. Then you take another 3 months, right? They keep growing, right? You in the tubes. You grow into then transplant into the greenhouse. Okay. So then you keep propagate. Hopefully the plant, the, you know, after 1-2 years, it will be big enough. You do have enough replicate to do the testing.
Okay. Yeah. So the time it takes from when you do that transformation at the single cell level mm-hmm. to where you have a nursery plant that's essentially ready to test, mm-hmm. you know, like a foot tall nursery plant, mm-hmm. what, 12, 18 months maybe?
Yeah, 12, 18 months. Yeah.
Okay.
Plus the 1 year ahead, so more than 2 years of
okay.
process.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a 2-year process just mm-hmm. to create a plant. Mm-hmm. And I know that when you're doing this, when you're doing the edits, when you're starting back at that single cell level, mm-hmm. it's not always, you don't always have success. Sometimes it's the efficiency is what, is it less than 10%? Is it?
It depends, it seems. There's many, let's see, many, many different challenges because protoplast editing is one of the most, high tech in agriculture, I think. Mm-hmm. So the editing is one difficult part, the regeneration different part, and also the selection of gene also is also affecting your success. Sometimes actually in our first one, actually we are very lucky to choose the level 1 gene, that is the cancer susceptibility gene. For some reason, even though it was very difficult to find to start with, but the mutation rate is really high. It's more than 97%.
Okay.
Allele or homozygous mutation. That's really unbelievable. Yeah. Okay. But for most of the other genes, it seems really dependent. Yeah.
So that's the reason I know we've talked about, and we'll talk a little more about the first plant that you've been able to develop is a citrus plant resistant to citrus canker. Mm-hmm. But it's because you have such a high success rate in transforming that gene or editing that gene. Mm-hmm. You knew what the gene was,
yeah.
One.
Yes.
And then you said, what, 90-something% or 80% success rate? That's mm-hmm. that's pretty high
yeah.
compared to when you're working with these genes that you think are responsible for HLB mm-hmm. susceptibility or resistance, mm-hmm. it's what, less than 10%, less than 1%, something like that?
Let's first clarify the level 1 editing. Uh-huh.
Okay.
So we basically generated 42 lines, 39 survived, then 38 homozygous and then value mutant is transgene free. Mm-hmm. So that's really, I think we are really, really a heavy surprise.
Okay.
So this is just, before the graining for the HRB, we just we have many, you know, many potential target, but not like a cancer really. We know for sure level mm-hmm. one it is. It's the right target we have to work on. For HRB, you have to choose more target because silas had not been cultured, right? So we have to, you know, we have many potential target. No, but it was not as certain as level one. Of course, our current study on the, you know, HRB being a pathogen triggered immune disease that help us to narrow down the target. But yeah. You know, not as
Okay, so really you're still kind of, it's kind of like the Easter egg hunt right now. You're still looking for the egg or in this case, the gene that's responsible for HLB or genes. You've got a pretty good idea of what you think it might be related to this ROS or the, reactive oxygen species?
Yeah.
That's results in the stress response to HLB that causes the decline of the plants. So I know you've got a number of lines. How many lines do you have right now that you've created that you're going to test?
Oh, it's a if you you know this one is we have many lines. Many of them actually are transgenic. It's genome edited line, but they use the transgenic approach.
Okay.
Because we really want to, you know, we have been working on that. We want to make sure we have the right target. We started work before the. Our transgene for gene editing technology was fully developed, right? So we have been, more than 100 lines.
Okay.
So for like a, maybe more than like a 40 target. Okay. So, but most of them are really transgenic, generated by transgenic gene editing. So those plants are some of the highest one probably this high, but 1.5 year old.
Okay.
So getting close to be tested on the HRB.
And again, in some of those, as you mentioned, those are still considered transgenic because you've been working on this, doing the transgenic approach using gene editing back before you'd perfected the transgene free.
Yeah.
And so you've got a lot of things kind of proof of concept, really, find out what works the best. But at the same time, you're still working on developing those as transgene-free plants as well.
Yeah.
And so you do have some lines of transgene-free that you're going to test against HLB, correct?
Transgene-free, that one is really small. You know, that's why most of them still in the Ph.D. state.
Okay.
Because you know, think about that, right? We really first generated the cancer rate line in 2021 and early 2022.
Okay.
So then we began to apply that technology in 2022, right? So you remember it takes like 10 months to 1 year, almost 1 year from PD to the next step.
Okay.
So we have very few the transgene free line. On the HRB target. Yeah.
So we probably have at least another year before those would be ready to go to the field, I would guess.
That's right. Okay. That's why for the transgene free line, that will take a little longer time. But many of the gene editing line use the transgenic approach. That's more. Ready.
And so that's what's going to the field as soon or as we speak. Some of these that are considered transgenic still, but they've been developed using CRISPR for these targets against HLB that you're interested in.
That's right. Some line. Some are actually ready to go to field right now, but we probably want to wait until next March, I think, because to avoid the cold front.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I guess the one of the good reasons or the interesting things about the transgene free, why we're so interested in that versus transgenics, is there's a difference in the regulatory process. So you're going to have multiple lines of plants, some that are transgenic, some that are not. What's the difference, I mean, in general terms, as far as getting those released to growers?
For the transgenic line, right, for the transgenic lines, you have to go through the IFAS, right? IFAS, EPA and FDA regulation, the mainly IFAS and EPA. If it's a transgenic, it's much more difficult and expensive process. For the transgene-free lines, it's much more simpler. I want to use our transgene-free cancer rate line as an example. We work with, IFAS really did an amazing job, and also EPA. They're really willing to help, and they speed up the process. It took us really within like IFAS took about a couple months. EPA also took a couple months. You know, go through the deregulation process. Now our transgene free concrete line is totally get approved at the at the federal level. We actually already sent the plan to DPI a new Bollywood program for the state program. So they are ready to get to be commercialized.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so it's a, as you mentioned, it's just a much shorter deregulation process because it's really kind of exempt from regulations, is my understanding. And so with these transgene free, you said what, 2 months to kind of get the approval for your canker resistant lines. And are those oranges or grapefruit or what varieties are, have you got those completed with canker resistant?
The one we have is the sweet orange cultivar, Hamlin.
Oh, Hamlin. Okay.
Hamlin. Yeah.
Okay.
We are still also work on grapefruit. And also Valencia. So Valencia, we think we'll get the, I think we'll get it pretty soon.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so those are already, so you've got them to DPI for cleanup, and are those gonna be going to the field trials really soon or?
Yeah, yeah, they're actually, I think also next March, because we really want to avoid the cold front,
make
sure they will survive the cold front. Yeah.
I think that'll be an important test for us, is because I guess they've not been in the field before. We've not seen how they hold up in the environment. But also, you know, the fruit production. We want to make sure that, you know, the fruit's the right quality and in bearing, you know, it bears good quantities of fruit. So that's all to come, I guess, in the coming year.
Actually, you know, the lab wagon, we think we might have some good effect against HIV as well.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The reason we think, because it seems affecting RS level.
Mm-hmm.
So I think if my hypothesis is right, so that means that plant might be have some tolerance against HRV2, but of course we need the data to support that.
Yeah, but it gives us a little bit of hope maybe that you've got something that's ready, it's transgene free, ready to go to the field, although it was developed for canker, because it, you know, again is affecting that ROS production, maybe it's has some tolerance if not resistance to HLB. So
that's our hope.
So I guess we'll know, start getting collecting data on that in the coming spring, and we'll see how that goes. So so you've got a lot of other lines being developed in the greenhouse. And do you have a lot of other targets you're working on right now in your lab? You're still developing new varieties or new lines, I should
say. Yeah, you know, we have published our, like, you know, first realized HIV is a pathogenic immune disease. You know, we really really at the cellular level of, you know, and now we really at the further narrow down at the genetic level, so we can know the what genes are involved. We have, I think, you know, HRP, even though it takes a long time to figure it out, I think actually many targets can generate HRP tolerant or resistant plant. It just makes sure the plant will be not only HRP tolerant or resistant, but also have a minimum effect on the plant characters like growth, like fruit quality, yield, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
So I think we have many targeted work.
Yeah.
Make sure that we, you know, the wine have at least negative effect.
Well, that's why we have to get them in the field to see how they do work and to make sure that they perform as expected. So,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Agree.
Okay, so it sounds like you've got a lot of things moving along to the field, and in the next year or so is going to be real exciting to see how these go. And anything else that's exciting you right now about your research?
I think the most exciting part is just try to really scale up the, you know, to make our select target. Or even we choose the 40 target. I think our most exciting target probably, I would say 7 or 8 target. I think those one our most most exciting target.
Mm-hmm.
So we really want to scale up and speed up on those target. Because you cannot only generate one line for each target. I think normally for each target you have generated like more than 10 lines, I think.
Okay.
Then each line you have do the propagation, right? For multiple replicate, for each different line, we normally do 15 at least biological replicate. And we propagate 15. Mm-hmm. Then basically you can, so you have enough replicated when you test in the field, so the data will be robust.
So so we know that it really works like you expect. So
Not only one line, one plant.
Yeah. No, we want to have replicated plants in the field, absolutely.
Yeah.
And I think one of the key points that you mentioned and that IFAS right now, you know, we're wanting to speed all this up. We see the value in this biotech approach using gene editing and CRISPR. From all levels of IFAS administration, you know, we've got support to expand and invest more heavily in the CRISPR gene editing research at the University of Florida. So I know you're right now we're in the process of building new screen houses to increase the amount of holding space for these plants to grow them up even faster so you can get those into field trials. A cup structure being built for to grow some of these plants in the field as well, which will be helpful. Your lab is expanding. We're hiring more people. And it's just, I think the whole point is that we're trying to give you and your lab crew all the resources you need to work as fast as possible. So I think everybody's excited about the future, that, you know, and the prospects for this. And we look forward to talking more about this in the future and getting updates on the progress.
Yeah, well, thank you, Dr. Roger, and you know, thank the CREC leadership, thank the IFAS, like Dr. Gibbard, Dr. Scott Engel, and also for the UF for the wonderful support. I think that's really, really helpful for us to speed up and scale up the process. Hopefully, we can get a plan to the city drawers as soon as possible.
Yeah, no, I think so. And also, I shouldn't overlook it. We're in the process right now. Also, funding coming from FDOC and possibly even CRDF to help speed this up as well. So a lot of people are involved in trying to bring this across the finish line as fast as possible. And so, Dr. Wang, we thank you for all your work. And we'll let you get back to your lab and get back to work and as fast as possible.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Ryder.
All right, thank you.